In this video, I will connect the CNC enclosure to the CNC machine itself.
Okay, I think what I need to do next is re-solder the correct aviation sockets.
The first thing I'm going to do is rewire the stepper motor panel sockets from the 4-pin ones I used to test the motors to 5-pin aviation sockets. I've used cable that can be shielded against electromagnetic interference. The extra pin on the panel mount will be soldered to the braided shield on the cable and then go to a ground terminal within the enclosure. I made a jig to hold the sockets while soldering by drilling a hole roughly the same size into a piece of ply. Once I tinned the contacts, I soldered these together. I also have to rewire one of the 4-pin JSD connectors to an extra cable as I'm using two stepper drivers for each of the motors of the Y-axis. When I originally tested the motors, I connected those two steppers together because the controller only had a total of 3 drivers.
So I put the crimp thing in there, and the idea is that you just push the wire in and squeeze it. So I've got about 4 mm of wire.
I'm not doing a great job filming this, but you have to press the crimp twice. The first time you hold the crimp terminal in the appropriate jaw of the pliers, push the wire in without knocking the crimp out of the jaws and do an initial crimping. That should hold the wire and crimp together loosely so you can move them further into the jaws to a raised section which re-crimps the connection so it's even tighter and so it can fit into the plastic plug.
Yep, that's better, it's gone all the way in.
This is something I just figured out while making a lot of mistakes. So an alternative to making the JST connections up yourself is to buy them pre-assembled.
So all you would have to do is solder onto the ends, you know, maybe cut it down and solder down here. Another alternative is to just simply not use these and to wire directly to the stepper drivers.
I'm now going to install all the proximity sensors to their mounting holes on the plates. I have 2 pairs of proximity sensors wired in parallel for the X and Y and a single sensor for the Z. I use a thin offcut of profile to line up the holes in the extrusion with the plates, drilling those out by hand. I'm going to hide some of the wiring by passing them through the aluminium profile. This was something I overlooked when designing and cutting the plates, but will make the finished CNC machine look a lot neater.
Just going to feed this through and just make sure it comes out on the other side.
I'm also going to shield the proximity sensor cables by passing them through copper braided sleeving.
Okay, I've been popping the sensors in their mounts. I've also got this braided copper sleeve, it's tinned, that's why it's this colour, which I'm going to put over the cables before I solder the extensions onto the panel mounts. And the reason I'm using this is to shield the wiring, so I reduce the likelihood that interference causes me problems.
When I add the braiding, which will make contact with the profile, the entire piece of aluminium will also act like a Faraday cage to shield those parts of the wire.
just need to connect the braid on these two to that one there. So from the proximity sensors, the brown goes to red, the blue goes to black, and the black goes to green. And I'm not using the white cable because these are three core and that's an extra one that I don't need. So I'm just going to wire the panel mount socket to the wire for this particular one, and if it works I'll then do the rest. Okay, so before I put the heat shrink on and screw it all together, I'm just going to plug it in and check that it works. And so it's really important to make sure all the proximity limit switches are plugged in, otherwise the controller will assume that there is a break in the circuitry because they are connected, and you won't get any homing. So I've done these two, which are the X and Y, and I just need to work out the length and resolder the Z. These are inductive, so I'm going to have to put some metal, maybe a screw or something in there. Unfortunately, I didn't add a mount here for the Z axis, so I think for now I'll just cable tie it on.
Around the same time, I tried to wire the pump and fan for the original water cooled spindle.
Okay, let's see what happens when I turn this on.
I had to give up because for some reason the pump wouldn't work. I probably could have spent several days working out what had gone wrong, but I decided to just buy an air-cooled spindle instead.
That's on. I can't hear that running there.
But before you smash the dislike button thinking I'm just throwing money at the problem, first of all, money is a valid and essential part to solving some of the more complicated problems in life. But I also blagged the water-cooled spindle for free, so it's not so much that I'm throwing money at the problem, but doing what I would have done had I not wasted my own time first. That and the fact that it's not the 1990s and technology has moved on to the point where we don't necessarily need water cooling apart from in the nuclear industry, which means it's safe to change my mind.
Okay, I've decided water cooled spindles are too much of a ball ache, so I'm going to undo all of these now. I've ordered a replacement air cooled spindle.
I'm now going to replace the water cooled spindle with the air cooled one.
I think sometimes you just have to accept it's okay to change your mind about something. I got this spindle for free. I tried to use the water cooling method, but I can tell it's just going to cause me more problems than it's worth. Just taking this stuff out is going to make so much more space in the trunking. I think the machine will look a lot neater as well. I bought a new air-cooled spindle and I'm going to replace the water-cooled one with this. It doesn't look as good quality as the previous one, and the socket's a little bit different too, so I'm going to have to rewire this. This one's got a nice spin to it, while this one stops a little bit more abruptly. The motor's probably been left in the cold for too long, and the grease and the bearings is just a little bit thicker than normal. So I think once this is turned on for 5-10 minutes, that should improve. The collet's also a little bit bigger on this one. This is an ER16, while the other one was an ER11, so at least I get a little bit more option with what I can attach to this.
The socket opening is a little smaller than the previous one, and I couldn't get it to fit after I'd replaced the plastic cover with the black braid and added the heat shrink over the cable. This entire build has been a complicated patchwork of mistakes for me, but I'm close to the end now.
Just double check that I've soldered this correctly. Number one is brown, Number two is black. Number three is grey. Number four is green and yellow.
Spindle works, but I can't actually control the RPM with software because I need to adjust some parameters in the gerbil config h file. So what you're seeing now is done by using the toggle switch and potentiometer to change the speed directly via the VFD. If I turn the spindle on by writing M3 in the command line in BCNC, the RPM goes to max and the toggle bar in the software is unresponsive. I want to move the machine around just to make sure everything works and to make sure that the steps are set correctly.
What the fuck happened there?
Fucking hell. I had one of the switches in the wrong position, so they were moving at different steps. Okay, anyway, here goes again.
So I think this is where you write congratulations in the comment section. Thanks for joining me on this journey, and especially to my handful of committed Uber patrons whose subscriptions have kept me stocked up with coffee and biscuits while I endeavour. You guys are absolute stars. The majority of the physical work is done and the machine and the enclosure are now connected. There's still a few problems I need to solve, including the emergency stop causing an overload message on the VFD, controlling the RPM in software, getting the surface scan feature to work on BCNC, and also three of the four stepper motors don't seem to hold when the machine is idle. I'm going to save those for a troubleshooting video, which is what I'll work on next, where I'll look at the software and firmware in a little more detail. I am a little daunted at the idea of delving into the cove of firmware, but I don't have a choice, is where I must go. So thanks again for watching, don't forget to sacrifice a thumb, and I'll hopefully upload a video soon.